Judas, that is recorded in history as the most gruesome act of disloyalty, deceit, inhumane, not integral, a thief, a betrayer, a traitor. This morning affords us the opportunity to consider Judas, the fallen apostle, from an angle that we've never done before. Historically, when we consider Judas, we often categorize him as the world's greatest criminal. After all, it was his act that turned over the Son of God to be murdered, to be pierced, to die. But there are some other angles to the story of Judas, in that many overlooked that he had a real relationship with Jesus. Often we forget that he was on many of the Messiah's missionary journey, but even before then, he was called. Jesus comes out and selects his first and last class of disciples. He selects Peter, and then James, and then John, but he does not exclude Judas from the equation. Jesus selects Judas, trains Judas, and knowingly gives Judas responsibility over one of the most important aspects of his ministry beyond miracles, and that's finance. Funding, he trusted Judas with his resource. Judas! the one we all blame, the name we use to refer to people who hurt us today, the name pastors give for people who decide to go to other churches, characterized as a gruesome betrayer, and the one to whom we blame for the death of the Messiah. Judas could not have been without the assignments that Jesus gave the 12. Remember when Jesus went out and he would go and send the apostles to diverse places after having taught, teaching them how to cast out demons and heal the sick. You see, Judas was too a first-hand witness of all the Messiah said, all the Messiah did. And by normal mathematical equation, Judas had to have been involved at many of the revivals. If it's true that Jesus sent him out two by two and then by 70, Judas had to have preaching responsibility. He had to have deliverance responsibility. He had to have a number of demons that came out by his own hand, because after all, he was called. He spent every day, every night, every second with Jesus for 3 years. Judas is with Jesus as Jesus transitions the 12 from being students, disciples, as the scripture would say. And the Messiah goes up to the mountain, the scriptures teach, in all night prayer. And when he comes down, he ordains them. And Judas is not at home. He is not eating. Peradventure, he would miss this. He is with them and he is ordained. Which means that maybe Judas had no real intention on betraying the Messiah. Maybe Judas was unaware that he had it in him to do what you and I demonize him for what he did. I don't believe that while he was healing and preaching or counting offerings, that he was plotting for the moment that he could turn the Messiah over to his murderers. He did not know it. There must have been real history, real companionship, real love between Jesus and Judas, because the Gospels never reveal a moment where Jesus outed him, knowing from the time he called him that he would be the one to do it. Jesus treated him the same as the others. Some would also argue that he probably preferred him. Peter was the primary student, but he didn't count money. John was the beloved. Jesus did not trust him with finance. It is written that where your treasure is, your heart is there. Gives us a deeper look at the feelings of Jesus to Judas the man. One day, after the consummation of their academic journey, and after the high point of them watching Jesus deliver the boy in the graves, or cast the demons into the pigs, or heal the woman with the issue of blood, we don't have one sentence out of the mouth of Apostle Judas. He does not say anything. He does not ask anything, which lends to most Bible scholars believing that he was a resolved man. He never doubted that Jesus was who he was. He didn't even give Jesus as many problems as Peter. Peter got rebuked, got scolded. Judas was a silent man. We have no language. And if I were to rebuke quote the scriptures. My pick would have been Thomas. You see, because all throughout Jesus' life, Thomas always had a doubt. Why wasn't he the devil? Even moving into the book of Acts, Jesus shows up, wounds still fresh. Thomas looks back and says, I still don't believe. Was he not the betrayer? At dinner, when the heat of the moment and the pressure of history leads into the Messiah, Peter looks at Jesus with a look of adoration. The one that he discipled to be the next leader of the move amongst the 12. And Jesus says, do you love me? Never a question he posed to Judas. Do you love me? Peter says, absolutely. I love you so much. Jesus asks three times. Peter says, why do you ask me this? Jesus from his own mouth says, you will betray me. Three times. Why isn't Peter considered the fallen apostle? He did the same thing Jesus did. The heat of this moment climaxes around the dinner table. And it makes us think that maybe Jesus did not see Judas the way you see Judas. Because his last two acts before he hands Jesus over were not brawls. They were not arguments. Peter, James, and John were quarrelsome. Who will be the greatest? Judas was not a part of those discussions. Followed by the writer, I would have assumed to insert Judas at some of the immaturity and the juvenile discussions amongst the 12. He is excluded at this table. The final supper, as we call it, the game changes. Jesus, being aware, having departed Gethsemane, the place where his will was crushed, so that the will of God could be done. Jesus says, one of you will betray me. And all of a sudden amongst themselves, there is a murmuring. Is it me? Is it me? Peter asks, is it me? James asks, is it me? John asks, is it me? Why would they ask if it was them, if it wasn't in all of them to betray him? Is it me? Is it me? Jesus looks at all of them, knowing all of their indecision, being fresh from a conversation where he questions his loyal proteges about who he is. Who do men say that I am? Jesus asks. Nobody but one has an answer, and Judas never even takes place in the discussion. Perhaps because he was more convinced than them all.
Teach.
At the dinner table, Jesus says, I'll let you know which one of you it is. I'm not going to leave it a mystery. I believe John the Beloved creeps in and leans on him closer. They are all wondering, who is he?
Yeah.
Is it me? And Jesus says, no. The one who touches my hand will be the one. Knowing the tenseness of this moment, I would have assumed that Jesus, in his righteousness, would have threw the table over, exposed him, kicked him out. Jesus does no such thing. In fact, goes down his eye. He lets Judas touch him, which makes us look a little closer now, because it means that it's possible to touch him and still betray him. Let us know that it's possible to have moments of intimacy and still take an offer and choose something other than him. Gives you some more perspective when Jesus himself says, if the two of you shall agree, ask by touching anything, it will be done. Which means, if we're using Bible to interpret Bible, Jesus touched Judas because of the power of agreement. Touch me, and we will agree at the events that are next. If that doesn't really decorate the whole scene, the next act of physicality, the next engagement between the Holy Lamb of God, righteous Messiah, the one who knew no sin, would not be a shoving match, would not be an argument, it would be a kiss. A kiss. A kiss. A kiss. So Jesus did not push back from the table. Keep your lips open. He did not look back and say, you peasant, I know what you've done. Don't kiss me. No, no. Jesus let Judas kiss him. It's an act of worship. Because maybe the truth is, if we dig into the 100-fold scale of the story, maybe Jesus saw in Judas what he didn't see in any of the disciples. Yeah, betrayer. Yeah, traitor. But maybe Jesus knew your message will be the most powerful message ever preached. Go ahead and kiss me. Psalms 2 says, kiss the Son, lest he be angry. Jesus shows no anger because he desired to have the lips of this man touch his face, perhaps for the story his life would forever tell. The next sentence of Jesus to Judas, certainly a game changer, misunderstood by most, makes you go into deep perplexity and considerations of what Jesus meant. When he looks at Judas, the one he loved, he never excluded him from the count of the redeemed. He was among the 12 when Jesus blew on them and said, receive the Holy Ghost. He looks upon them and he says this word, the thing that you do, and on Resurrection Sunday, I too have been self-righteous, angry at Judas. But then, I wonder, why was Jesus in a rush? Why did he encourage Judas to hurry? Didn't he want more time with the 11? These were their last moments. Certainly, he could have got one more squeeze out of John the Beloved. But he says, hurry up! That means that whatever Judas' life would display needed to go out. So then, perhaps Judas, who is credited as the most wicked man in history, Satan, we call him, the son of perdition from the beginning, we call him, maybe he was the most significant apostle there. Perhaps it was Judas' act that catalyzed the gospel. We have heard the epistle of Paul, and we have heard the epistle of Peter, and we have read the epistle of James, and we look upon Judas as if he did not have a message too. I beg to differ. Now we sit here, as righteous as we are, as redeemed as we are, as churched as we are. I had a praying grandmother as we are, musical choiring as we are, righteous and bound in Jesus' name as we are. I can shake our heads, disgusted with Jesus. But maybe the truth is, you have a little of him in you too. Hebrews chapter 6 makes this a game-changing story. When Paul, reflecting on the betrayal and reflecting on the story of Jesus, says these words. Everyone that tastes the heavenly gift and has seen Jesus deliver and seen him heal and seen him rest, when they taste that and opt out, they crucify the Son of God afresh. Which means that it is inaccurate to think that resurrection is about the one time he died. Because the truth is, you stabbed him this morning. You turned him in yesterday. You let him go Friday night at the bar. You took it off of last Wednesday in fornication. The truth is, we're hard on Judas, but we all got a little of him in us. Because we don't realize how fresh the wounds of Jesus still are. Because I know he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he's been resurrected, and he has crowns of thorns. But every time you remember what he did for you, and you don't do the same for him, every time you see him heal and you choose not to be healed, every time you see him deliver and you are out of deliverance, you have the Roman soldiers. Yes, you. Yes, you. Even you. You make him remember the agony on the cross. Because you, like Judas, you have seen him do it as well. You've watched him heal, save, deliver, raise up. You've heard his voice. Come! You've seen his purpose for you. And there are moments where Satan makes an offer and you opt out. You turn him in. Your offer may not be 30 pieces of silver. Maybe it's a man. Maybe it's a woman. Maybe it's a preference. Maybe it's a refusal to cooperate with his lordship. So it makes us be less hard on Judas, because now we realize. Remember a moment where the devil made me an offer. And after even having seen his goodness, I took the offer and traded him in. Yes, we crucify him every day. And we come today in our little stupid pastels and our expensive weeds. And we act like this is such a good day for the lost. But the truth is, you're lost. So every moment you choose something over him. A lover, a lifestyle, liquor, alcohol, perversion, a career, a timing, a pace, a desire, a way of life, a matter of life, even yourself. You become Judas Junior. So now we're looking at Judas with a little more mercy, because the truth is, we've all stabbed him. If you reflect your week, or you reflect your text messages, or you reflect what you've done in the last 30 days, when was the last time you traded? Judas Judas, who for a moment, just one moment, not even an hour, not even a year, not a month, who for a bad moment took something and turned it in. He gives us the most important message of all of the Holy Writ. I know it's not the gospel of grace. We like that one. Particularly those of us who want to do whatever the heck we want to do and sing Amazing Grace when we're done. Because after all, he knows my heart. Didn't he know Jesus too? God knows. We have an understanding. I'm taking my time. Judas gives us a message, a gospel more supreme than grace, a gospel more significant than Peter the water walker. Yeah, I know. He didn't live long enough to write an epistle, but his life is screaming to every one of us today. And do you know what the message of Judas is? The final moments of his life, after he tried to trade in what he took, the final minutes of his life, as he realized what he had done, and he heard the voices calling him, stuff talking to him, fears talking to him, witchcraft talking to him, sexual perversion talking to him, pockets talking to him, addiction talking to him. He lost his mind. He lost his mind. Now, the message of Judas screams to us, the gospel of Judas screams to us. Do you know what Judas preaches? Lean in, beloved. In a situation where I have to choose life without him, after I've seen him, I may as well die. Because life without Jesus is not life at all. Life on the other side of him is not life at all. Judas teaches us that you may as well hang yourself. If you act out of what he wants for you, if you act out of what he did for you, if you act out of having seen him. Judas gives us this message. I would rather die than do life without Jesus. I can't live remembering all that I saw and all knowing that I'll never again get to act in what I traded in. Consider now how this speaks to all of us. The guy that goes down in mystery as the criminal, as the one who did the criminal act in Germany, the guy that we have all pouted our and tooted our nose in the air as we do everything he doesn't want and opt out of everything he does. Consider now this gospel. Judas said, life without Jesus is not life at all. I would rather die than live another day without the man Jesus Christ. Judas said, I would rather spill my guts than go another day knowing I can't repent and I can't come back into my calling and I can't go back with the 12 and I can't be a part of what his story is. I would has a simple, powerful gospel. He preaches from the grave every day. And the name of his message is Betrayed. Judas didn't live long enough to choose. He didn't know mercy and grace, so he's not as lucky as you and I. He couldn't have changed his mind because the man was already gone. So because he couldn't change his mind, he took his life. Because I saw it firsthand. I saw him cast devils out. I witnessed him do what no other man could do. And I still took another offer. I auctioned him off. And when I tried to give it back, the sex was not worth it. The perversion was not worth it. I tried to give it back and they wouldn't even take it. Judas screams out, the danger of indecision is the equivalent of death. Judas's gospel says, you don't have a right to not be ready. Altar calls and you sat through and watched as vulnerable people came down the aisle and you clapped them upon his hands saying, I'm going to be real with God. I'm not going to play games with God. Judas says, I wish I were you. I wish I had the right to not be ready. But even with your not being ready, heaven is ready for you. Judas's gospel is keeping it real gone wrong. What happens when you fight to be like the others when you have seen the other side? So now we have more respect for Apostle Judas, the son of perdition, who was the devil from the beginning because you and I were full of the devil too. The scriptures say it back that before we submit to Jesus, our father was the devil. So you, me, we, us, we're just as much a Judas as the man himself. But right now, under this anointing, courage is rising in your heart. And this is the kind of courage that says, you know what? I may not be ready. I may actually enjoy what I'm in. I may actually get quite a bit of comfort. I'm not choosing as many times as he reaches for me. But I think I'll make a decision. And the decision is, life without him is not worth living. Life without him is not worth seeing. I don't even want to see love if I have to see life on the wrong side of righteousness and on the wrong side of deliverance and on the wrong side of the kingdom. I will not live without him. If that's you and you know the dealings of God are upon your heart right now, stand up and commit to heaven right now. I'll never do life without him. Come on your feet right now. I won't do it without you. Come on, church. Throw that hands up and make a commitment out of your mouth right now. It's quiet. It's quiet. But hell is raging. Heaven is peering in right now. I won't do it without you. That is my decision. I won't do it without you. I don't want to see life without your lordship. Lift your hands, church, and make him Lord again, will you? Come on, let an agony come upon you. Yourself. this moment is precious, because it means this is the last moment that you get to live without knowledge of your actions. And if you don't make a choice today, then it means you've made a choice. You've taken the silver and you've traded him in. You've auctioned him off for what you want more. There are men in this room right now. This is strictly a salvation altar call. We're going to do other things, so I don't want you to get bored. But there are those of you who refuse to make a decision. You know church real well. You just never made him Lord, and you've been getting by on your grandmammy's mercy. I need to be saved. I don't know how to do it. I have things that I want that I shouldn't. But I want to know him as Lord. I don't want to die without having ever tried it for real. That's you, you're here. And I want to be saved. Run down to this altar like your life depended. Don't think about it. Don't look at your neighbor. Don't give consideration to who you've been. Now, come on, come now. I'm backslidden. I'm backslidden. Come on, come now. Come now. Come now, come now, come now. All nations, help me pray, will you? This is a serious moment. Come now. I left him. Come on now. I left him. Come on. I left him for fornication. I left him for Allah. I left him for Buddha. I left him for the occult. I left him because of what other people did. I left him because I was mad at church. I left him. The fire of God is dealing with you right now. I left him for the water.
Quit, and today you know the conviction of the Holy Ghost come out.
You're not making it up. Come on, Hutchinson, start asking people all up there, come back. Come back. It's still coming. I don't care if they got a line up in all of these aisles. Come now, come now, come now. I loved him, I loved him, I loved him. I grew up in church and I walked away. I walked away. I walked away. The Spirit of God says there was some of them in the balcony. There's a man particularly. And he used to preach as a boy. And somebody died in your family and you got angry at God. And you walked away from the ministry. Run down here now. The Spirit of God is arresting you. You are under arrest. You are under arrest. Come now. You are under arrest. Every bastard preacher in here. You are under arrest. You are under arrest. You are under arrest. Now, this is not a join our church altar call. We're going to do that in a minute, but listen to me. I want to make an appeal to those of you that are there. And you're wrestling in your heart, but you don't feel ready. There is not a such thing. You can't be ready without Jesus. Don't you wait for your own readiness, because you don't have any need to be ready. Whether or not you're ready is irrelevant, because he's ready to receive you. You may have a bag of weed in your pocket, condoms in your wallet. You may have had to turn your phone off from texting somebody else's husband or somebody else's mother. Come now where you are. Now you are. Just where you are. Come again.
Thank you.
Come on now. He's talking to you. 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 When your mother's name is Linda, and she called you a slut last week, come now. He's talking to you. He's talking to you. Come now. Sitting up there, your grandmother was the only person you trusted. You don't trust your mama because she's an alcoholic, and your daddy has been absent. And when your grandmother died, you left God. Come here! The prayers of that woman is reaching for you. Her name was Edna! Come now. The Holy Ghost is reaching for you. Molested by a man on an organ, a man in a church on an organ, fondled you, and it means you think all preachers were wicked. Get up here right now. You know who the Holy Ghost is doing. I see you coming. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. I see. You're barren. You can't have children. And you're thinking that they don't know if it's ovarian cancer or if it's just uterine fibroids. If you will come today, the Spirit of God will heal you as a sign. Hear me, young lady. Come now. Let's count these souls. We're going to make a confession. Give me something to count everybody up here. Come on. 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52. Let's give it our praise for all 53. Let's give it our praise for 53 souls. Let's go out of these hands, out of the hands of death, out of the hands of hell, out of the hands of the ground. Leave them in Boston. Leave them. I want every one of you to hear me. Lift your hands right now. Close your eyes. Because I don't want you distracted. Now, you are without a church home, you have another altar call. This is not that. This is straight that I want to get right with God.
Yes.
Lift those hands right now. Knowing that He is greater than the thing you were willing to trade Him for. And repeat after me, Heavenly Father. Come on, say it now. Heavenly Father, I acknowledge you as the Lord of my life. And I repent right now of all of my sins and whatever I've done to trade you in. And I ask you now that you would be my God, that you would be my Lord. Come on, that you would take seat on my heart and be Lord again. Forgive me, wash me in your blood, and present me before the Father. I believe in my heart and I confess with my mouth that I am saved by grace. If the Son of God, who loves me and gave his life for me, the Holy Spirit, I invite you in my life. Show me how to live for you. Say it, show me how to live. And I'll live for you. In Jesus' name. Come on, if you're at this altar, I want you to rejoice right now.
Okay, we have 12, 13, 14, 15, 16,
18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, some of those completions, 27, 28, 29, 30, is another one, 31, we got 31, come on church! Speak with other tongues. But as I thought about this message, I screamed the word this morning, and I felt a level of deliverance on my mind from one word. The whole betrayal thing may or may not be applicable to you, but I looked in my mirror this morning and lifted my hands, and the Holy Ghost asked me to say something, and I'm going to ask you to say something right where you at. You may be saved, you may be sanctified. As I stood in my room and I lifted my hands, the word that came out of my mouth was forever. Now, you know how you stand at an altar with a bride and you say something out of your mouth, to death do us part? God asked me this morning if I was in it for the long haul. And I yelled out forever and I felt something leave me. I don't know what it was or who it was. But I had my own deliverance by screaming out forever. Give me a minute real quick. Yeah. us in the room, you're saved, you're sanctified. But you just need to reinforce the decision right now. That no matter what church people do, your mama do, no matter how much money you got, or whether your career works or none of that, I'm in this thing for the long haul. I'm gonna count to three. Now you can do it or you can not do it, but this is for those of us that just need to reinforce our commitment to this thing. Just need to let the Lord know one more time, I'm yours. I'm gonna count to three. And I'm gonna let you scream the word forever. And I believe deliverance is gonna fall in your mind.
Until I was naked, if I had on this Cinderella garment, I'm ready to go clean
out. Cause that thing, I'm telling you, there's a level of favor that I'm not gonna quit out of you. And you don't care about accusations or persecutions. Some of you too pop to say forever. There's still a condition on your sensitive self. You can't have your favor because you are not committed. But I came to tell somebody, I'm committed